On Wednesday, the so-called anti-mandate protest at Parliament came to its furious and tumultuous end. And fact, Aotearoa, fight against conspiracy theories, fact says misinformation was a major contributor to why some protesters were there, why some of them were so very angry, and why some of them are still intent on protest action. Now, fact are calling for those responsible to take responsibility. Remember, there have been calls for arrests, trials, even executions. And much of the justification for that appears to have come from sources and individuals for whom so-called facts appear to have been created almost as if to weaponise rage. Now that the occupation has come to a close, we're joined by a member of Fact Aotearoa, Stephen Judd, to discuss how much misinformation and conspiracy theories were a part of what led us to this protest and its anger. Stephen, welcome. Yeah. Welcome to Breakfast. It's lovely. Right. Thank you for coming in.
Yeah, no,
really nice to have you here.
Yeah.
You really give a damn about this, don't you? Because
the consequences are so serious. I mean, there's the first consequence. If people don't get vaccinated because they're told lies, they might get sick and they might die. And beyond that, the kind of underlying theme of so much of this conspiracy thinking is that government is corrupt, illegitimate, and in fact our whole society is, and so the only thing you can do about it is direct action that's going to include serious violence. And when people start believing that, okay, so there's the danger of violence and stuff, but also, you know, there's the social bonds, our social fabric, our social cohesion, our ability to have conversations where we have some kind of common understanding about what's going on in the world. If we don't have a common understanding about basic facts, then we can't make compromises, decisions, be together as a society the way that, you know, we would like to be.
I'm just going to do a dumb trick. I'm just going to hold this piece of paper up.
Yeah.
This piece of paper is white, right?
Right.
If someone is screaming at you that it's black and you're fake news and you're lying to them, I don't know what the hell to say. And this is the impasse we're at. Grant Robertson yesterday talked about funding public media. But the fact of the matter is, those people won't be watching this interview. They sure as hell won't be listening to Morning Report. So how do we get to them? How do we engage with them?
Well, I think the first thing you've got to think about is people didn't get here through reasoning their way in. They got here because of their pre-existing beliefs and their vulnerability, often emotional vulnerability, that lets the bad guys push their buttons. And so you can't necessarily counter misinformation just directly with new information. It's actually about connecting to people's underlying needs that got them there, right? They got there through emotional reasons and they're going to leave via emotional reasons.
And I read somewhere, and it was a wonderful piece of writing, mm-hmm. that some of the people at Parliament were formerly once uplifted by the state, what we now refer to as Oranga Tamariki kids, right? So you could understand why they might not trust any government because their lives have been devastated by the government's mishandling of their childhood. So how do we deal with those people? And what do we do about the bad guys?
Oh, yeah, man, this is just like not a short answer, and it's a really complicated answer. And one of the things is it's just really, really difficult because different people's stories of how they got there are different. So we could look at people whose lives have been disrupted by the pandemic itself and our response to the pandemic and whether we've helped them the right way, whether we should help them differently. We can look at the situation they were in even before the pandemic happened.
Truly.
And in terms of the bad guys, we've got a real problem, if you like, in a free and open society because there's really sharp limits to what governments can and should do. In terms of shaping public opinion and informing the public.
And this is the thing, isn't it? And I need to explain to our audience, if you and I lie now, or if we call somebody something that is manifestly not true and don't give them the right of reply, the fires of hell will rain down on us. We could be sued for defamation. The Broadcasting Standards Authority could actually take the show off air. But if Facebook publishes aberrant nonsense, cynical, deceitful, misleading nonsense, there's no consequence often. There's no one policing that stuff. So how do we go after the publishers?
Well, look, that's a really good question. And in fact, like, I'll give a very tiny bit of credit. Facebook have some very loose community standards, and some of the biggest operators in the space in New Zealand aren't on Facebook because they can't even meet that incredibly low bar. And when they are using social media, they'll delete critical comments. They'll basically remove any possibility of reply. But look, we do have mechanisms in New Zealand that, you know, in terms of like the classification office, for example, that place some limits. And yeah, look, it's complicated.
It's really complicated.
We're mostly looking at why and how this happens. What to do about it is a problem that's confounding people everywhere. Otherwise, we would not be in this mess.
So there are two groups of people, it seems to me, here. There are the people who are cynical, the bad guys, you call them, who are actually willfully misleading.
Yeah.
And some of whom are full of so much rage that it's almost impossible to understand it. But there's the vulnerable people who are prone to them.
Yeah.
And how, this is the question, how the hell did they get together? The bad guys targeted the vulnerable guys, did they?
It's not even targeting, right? Because if you have a message and it reaches a sufficiently large audience, the call will be answered by people who are ready to hear it, right? So if you are constantly blasting this stuff out through your, you know, crappy online video channel or spamming social media, and don't forget that there are organised groups pumping disinformation out elsewhere in the English-speaking world. You know, I think some of what we're seeing is spillover from that. We talk about overseas actors sometimes, but you know, people here are just participating in a dialogue that's actually kind of worldwide.
Stephen, I just want to interrupt, and we're almost out of time, but I just want to say this isn't about the legitimacy of debates over mandates and whether the government should have that kind of power. Actually, that's crucial to a democracy. This is about the next level, Nuremberg 2.0, pictures of people being hanged.
This is about people who think that the government's poisoning your kids and that that's part of a global conspiracy to bring about who knows what. And if you believe that, you're going to do bad stuff. That's the problem, right? It's not about policy debates.
Thanks, Stephen. Wow. I think our responsibility is the effort to communicate with people. Mm-hmm. And we are called broadcasters, and broad means everyone. But there are some people that I've never felt it harder to get to. And we have to have this discussion about what we do.
So the real problem, like I've been reading about de-radicalisation, it's a one-on-one thing.
Yeah.
And that so government doesn't going, hi John, we've come to talk to you about your...
Don't go yet, Stephen. Yeah. We're still here.
Man, I'm so relaxed. Tribute to this man, yeah.
Yeah. Hey, I love the extent to which you give a damn, because this matters. Because if we leave people to these cynics, we're going to lose them for good.
Yeah.
Stephen Judd from Fact Aotearoa, thank you for coming, and we really appreciate it.